मॉर्निंग सर। ओके, वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल। द एमिनेंट स्पीकर ऑफ टुडेज वेबिनार डॉक्टर मुक्ति आर सिंह, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ अप्लाइड फिजिक्स DTU दिल्ली, ऑनरेबल प्रिंसिपल डॉक्टर विक्रमजीत सिंह, ऑर्गेनाइजिंग सेक्रेटरी ऑफ द वेबिनार मिस्टर नरेंद्र कुमार, members of the organizing committee, all the worthy participants and dear students, on behalf of the organizing committee and DN College family, it's my extreme pleasure and honor to welcome you all in this national webinar. It's really a matter of pride, privilege for me that I got the opportunity to get you introduced to our chief guest, Dr. Mukti R. Singh. As I told you that he at present is working as professor in the Department of Applied Physics, DTU Delhi. He has also served the DN College from 2014 to 2017 in the Department of Physics. We can very well assess his contribution in the field of research just by knowing that he has published more than 25 research papers in peer-reviewed journals and conference proceedings. For his research papers, he has also been awarded so many times, among which he received a commendable research award for excellence in research awarded by DTU Delhi in 2021. He received International Travel Support grant by DST. As a student also, he got first prize at Inter-University Science Convention held at KUK. He got Best Poster Award in 55th DAE Solid State Physics Symposium held at Manipal University. As a mentor, at present he is guiding 4 PhD students, 4 BTech project students and 2 MSc project students. These are working under his supervision at present. He also received a UGC startup grant of rupees 10 lakh for his ongoing research project entitled Investigation of Hazular Alloys for Thermoelectric Applications. So in sum and substance, I can say today we are having among us a great academician and an outstanding researcher. It's impossible to summarize his huge contribution in the field of physics in this short span of time. So I am really thankful to Dr. Mukti R. Singh for sparing his valuable time to inculcate scientific temperament and aptitude in all of us to guide we all for the research and the latest technological advancements. As we all know that the topic of today's conversation is quantum information science. So now I would like to invite Dr. Mukti R. Singh to enlighten us on this topic. And I would like to say something to the participants also. You will have to listen each and everything very carefully, and you can put your queries and questions in the chat box, because we are streaming this particular webinar through Zoom as well as on YouTube also. So I would like to say that you can, if you are joining it through Zoom, you can put the queries in the chat box of the Zoom. And if you are you are joining through YouTube link, then you can put your queries in the chat box. Then in last, there will be a query and question round, which will be handled by Dr. Himani Gupta from our college. She will be asking and she will be putting your questions to Dr. Mukti R. Singh, and he will be answering each and every question. So you can put every query in the chat box, and in between no one will disturb. You will have to listen it carefully, and in last you can put your queries. Okay, thank you very much. Now over to Mukti R. Sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you once again for sparing time. Now I would like to Mukti R. Sir to start the webinar. Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the for your kind words. Although I do not deserve these heavy words. Thank you very much. I have a special bond with BN College, as you said, sir. I have served there at least 3 years, and then I moved here. So, and I also thank Chetan sir for inviting me for this webinar, to being a resource person. So, should I keep my video on for the talk, or can I switch it off, because it consumes a lot of bandwidth? Hello, am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, you are audible, sir.
Okay, so my question is, should I keep my video on during the lecture, or should I off it, because it consumes a lot of bandwidth?
Sir, no problem. Yeah, because only yours video will be on, so you can on it. No problems. Right. As you wish.
Then it's so. Okay, sir. Okay. So, okay. Without wasting time, let me go to today's talk. So for that, let me share my screen. I hope my screen is visible.
Yes, sir. Yes, it's quite clear. No issue.
Okay. Okay. So this is basically a quite a new area for research, because from the 70s of last century, there is a continuous development in this area. But as far as the academic is concerned, this is quite new course for the academics, and it is an emerging field of interdisciplinary research, because it involves the physics at the most, and the mathematics, computer science, and information technology. So this is of course an interdisciplinary research area. For research and also, of course, in engineering. So, actually, we in our department, we are running a course, BTech in Engineering Physics. So there is a full-fledged paper on this course. Okay. So that's why, because I got an interest, because I'm teaching this course from last 5 years. One more thing, our university also got a Center of Excellence from the Government of India to set up a center of excellence in this particular area. Because recently, in the last union budget, there is a special provision kept for such emerging areas. So one of them is quantum information science, and other is like artificial intelligence and all these. So of course, the government is, this area is attracting the attention of governments. And why it is attracting the attention of government, and government is putting so much money in this area, I will let you know during my lectures. Okay, right. So anyhow, if you have any queries regarding, although sir said we have the query session at the end, but by the way, if any have any important questions regarding my slides or anything, so he or she can ask during the lecture. So first of all, let me thank the Delhi Technological University. And this is our Department of Applied Physics. It's a very big department. And we are having almost 20 faculty members in the department. And the course offered by our department, as I said, the BTech Engineering Physics, it's a very high-end course. And we teach the students fundamental as well as the applied physics and very advanced physics, like course like quantum information in that course. We also have MSc physics course, MTech in material science and engineering, and of course PhD. So almost we are having more than 100 research scholars currently working in the department with the different faculty members. So I would like to thank the department and the Delhi Technological University for all the facility. Now, coming to the point, the content of this lecture will be as, first of all, we will try to understand what is quantum information science is. And then from starting of this area till today, we will discuss various milestones, because that's very important. And then we move to the basic of quantum information science, in which we discuss the basic of the quantum computers. What are the various components of a quantum computer, and how physics is helping. And at the last, if time permit, we will discuss one application of quantum information and science. Right. So quantum information and science, as I said, is a interdisciplinary research area, which involves physics at the most, and computer science, information technology. And during the last century, these are the subjects like physics, information theory, computer science, and the mathematics and computing. So these are the courses during the last century, which got the highest attention of the scientific community. And in this century also, the starting of 21st century, a new synthesis of these themes is underway. And that is the emerging discipline of quantum information science, which provides us a new insight into fundamental problems relating to both computation and physical science. Basically, here we explore in this, basically the quantum science, which is doing all the wonderful thing here. And you know that during the last century, I hope the audience is mostly from the undergraduate level. And I kept this topic of this talk is so basic, because I do not involved here the lot of mathematics or mathematical jargons. So I'm keeping this very basic just to make the students understand this topic. And the aim of this topic, aim of this talk, is not to make you understand the QIC in one day, in 1 hour, but I want just to make the people motivate toward this area, because this is quite new area and a lot of opportunities are lying ahead. So this new field basically leading us to revolutionary advances in field of science and engineering, involving all these areas relating to communication, precision measurement, and fundamental quantum science. So now there is a basic question. We are talking about the quantum information science. So there is a natural question. So what is the classical information science? So therefore, it is pertinent to here to make a difference between the classical information science or classical information theory and the quantum information theory. So as far as the classical information theory is concerned, we know that our today's computer, which works on the logic gates, and their basic is 0 and 1. So this is the logic. So the information in terms of 0 and 1 on which our today's computer based is called the classical information theory. And it is a mathematical theory of information processing, of course, and storage and transmission of information. So this is basically the classical information. Now, quantum information theory, as I said, the classical information theory based on the laws of classical physics. It obeys the laws of classical physics, right? Whereas the quantum information theory obeys the laws of quantum mechanics. And the quantum mechanics, we know that it is it is something beyond our common sense. Means we cannot understand the quantum mechanics while keeping the classical common sense, classical notion. If we have to understand the quantum mechanics, we have to leave our classical notion behind, and then we have to think as a naive mind. So that then only we can understand the quantum mechanics. Why I'm saying that? because the principles of quantum mechanics, the observations of quantum mechanics are definitely violating our common sense. And of course, our common sense is wrong. Okay, so that's why if we have to understand the quantum mechanics, we have to leave our classical notion behind. And we have to approach this field from a new mind, from a new mind. So the quantum theory is the study of how such tasks, means the tasks are same, like processing of information, processing of data, like storing of data, the tasks are same, but how these tasks now can be accomplished using quantum mechanical system, quantum mechanical laws. So this is the difference between, a basic difference between the classical information theory and quantum information theory. And we can also say that the it deals with, the quantum information science deals with how the quantum mechanical properties of a physical system can be exploited to achieve efficient storage and transmission of information. Because you know that today we are running out of space, running out of memory, right? You know, even every day we are getting a new, new device, new phone device, having 3 GB RAM, 4 GB RAM, 8 GB RAM, 16 GB RAM, even that much memory cannot solve our purpose. Okay, so this technology basically coming very fast. We will discuss on this technology also in coming slides. But this notion on which these devices are based, basically are running out of time as well running out of space. So these devices cannot help us. If we have to, you know, learn new things, if we have to analyze new things, if we have to analyze this universe, we have to approach to the new computational devices, and which of course depend upon the quantum information science. So briefly, this picture basically explain the where the classical information theory lies. Okay. So the well-established theory of classical information on which our today's communication system based is basically a very small part of very large picture. We know that maybe the final students are quite aware of that the quantum mechanical theory, the quantum theory is a more general theory and classical theory is its special case. And we used to prove this in our classroom. Right, so the classical, as such, the classical information, of course, is a small subset of a very large field, which is the quantum information science. And the quantum mechanics, as I should say, this is the theory of everything. Although today we are not in a position to say the quantum mechanics is a theory of everything, but constantly we are moving toward that milestone. That one day, maybe in 20 or 30 years, this theory would become the theory of everything. Now, after discussing these very basic difference between the classical information theory and quantum information theory, let me discuss with you the milestones this new young infant field achieved during last 50 to 60 years. So first of all, the idea of a computational device based upon quantum mechanics emerged when scientists were investigating the fundamental physical limit of a computation. Now, what is the fundamental limit of a physical computation? As I just said, so we are running out of space, we're running out of time using classical information theory. Okay, so the fundamental law, I should say, the empirical law given by one of the scientists, Gordon Moore. So he was the co-founder of Intel, and in 1965, he gave a law, he gave an empirical law. Okay, that empirical law basically about the limitation and the fundamental limits, physical limits on the computation. So what was that law basically? He said that it was based upon integrated chip on which our today's computer or our phones are based. He said that the number of transistor per square inch on an integrated chip had doubled every 18 months. It means continuously the space of chip is decreasing and the logic which is packed on that chip is increasing. And this doubling is taking place in just 18 months. So here I have shown the picture. The blue line shows the prediction of the Moore's. Okay. Okay, so now we are today in 2021. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, yes, sir.
Okay, so in 2000, right. So in 2021, more than 10 billion transistors are packed on a 1 mm square area of chip. Okay, so ultimately, basically, we are moving toward the miniaturization. We are, you know, reducing the size of the device and packing more logic. But what is the end of this? Ultimately, we reach at the level of atoms. And that will surely be the end of silicon roadmap, because we cannot go beyond the level of atom. Because when we go beyond the level of atom, the quantum mechanical effects are coming to pictures. And when quantum mechanical effect come into picture, then they govern the physics via quantum mechanical law. But our existing theory, our existing computers are based upon classical theory. Ultimately, we cannot go beyond that level. We cannot go beyond the level of atom. So that was the question which was in 1970s, people are thinking on, people are working on. And this basically leads the people to think in a different way. Means if the silicon roadmap end, so what will be the future of communication? What is the future of computational devices? So that leads people to think in a different direction, and that direction basically is the quantum mechanical laws. So the thought that the computational device must be based upon quantum mechanical law. So in this area, first of all, in 1982, Feynman, gave the first hint in that area, and he showed that how a quantum system could be used to do the computation. So that was the first instance when this area of this name of quantum information science was heard by the world. Recently, after Feynman in 1985, David Deutsch, basically he is the one of the pioneer of this work, and even today we are we used to study his algorithm. First of all, he gave in 1985. The first quantum mechanical Turing machine. So let me tell you what is Turing machine is. Turing machine is a mathematical model of today's computer. It is a mathematical model of today's computer, which was given in 1936 by Alan Turing. So we call it Alan Turing thesis. So that was the mathematical model of today's computer. And David Deutsch in 1985 proposed first universal quantum Turing machine. Okay, and paved the way to quantum circuit model. Then in 1984, Peter Shor came up with a quantum algorithm to factor a very large number in polynomial. Okay, if we have to factor a very large number, more than six digit, classical computer cannot do that job. It will crash. Okay, but that work can be done in a fraction of seconds using the quantum computers. And that was shown by Peter Shor in 1994. Recently, after that, in 1995, the first realization of quantum logic gate was done in Boulder, Colorado, USA. And in 1996, I'm discussing the milestones. So when, what happens? In 1996, Lau Grover, an engineering from the Bell Laboratory, USA, developed a quantum search algorithm. Okay, of course, the algorithms are the heart of any computer. So of course, we have to have a algorithm. So first algorithm was given by Lau Grover. We will discuss in detail what is this algorithm is all about. Okay, and a year later, in 1998, the first quantum computer based upon nuclear magnetic resonance technique was proposed. And in 1998, with a 2-qubit register, 2-qubit means classically equivalent to 2-bit, was scaled up to 7-qubit in the Los Alamos National Laboratory. So the first model and first working quantum computer was proposed in 1998. And today, recently in 2019, Google achieved a quantum supremacy, taking 200 seconds to perform on a 53-qubit quantum. Remember, in 1998, it was a 7-qubit quantum computer. And in 2019, it was a 53-qubit quantum computer. It performed a task in 200 seconds, that would take the fastest supercomputer of today's 10,000 year. So if we use today's fastest computer available on this earth, it will take 10,000 year to solve that problem, which was solved in just 200 seconds by that particular quantum computer. So this is around 150 million times more faster than our today's fastest computer. I'm telling you about fastest computer. So this is an enormous speed, you can say, is enormous speeds. So this is the milestone and this is the motivation behind this this new area, why we go for a research in this area. So having understood the milestone, the what happening at what time, now we move toward the basic of the quantum information science. So here in this section, in the very basic section, we will review the basic gates, quantum gates, quantum circuits, and of course quantum algorithm. And we will see how these quantum circuits or quantum gates are much more efficient than our existing classical gates. And for more detail, if anybody is interested in this, he can read this book, Nielsen and Chuang. It's a very wonderful book. Right. So first of all, like in classical, the basic unit of classical information is a bit, is a classical bit, like 0 and 1. So every information, regardless of size, saved in our hard drive in terms of 0 and 1. So this is the basic unit of information of classical computations. So what would be the basic unit of information, of quantum informations? And the answer is the qubit. Q for quantum, bit for, the bit is the same as classical bit. So it is qubit. The qubit is the quantum analog of the bit, the classical fundamental unit of information. It is a mathematical object with specific properties that can be realized in an actual physical system in many different ways, I will tell you. So you know that the classical informations, classical bit can have a 0 or 1 value. Qubit can also have ket 0 or ket 1. These are the Dirac notations. So qubit can also have ket 0 or ket 1. But in addition to that, it have also something else, which is there is no classical analog of that. And that is the superpositions of 0 and 1. So we can also have the state of a system, the state of a quantum system, exist in a superpositions of cat 0 and cat 1, where alpha and beta are complex number. So this is a particular state of a quantum mechanical system. So here, let me spend 1 minute to give you an idea about the quantum mechanics, the amazing things about the quantum mechanics. So we know that if we talk about the electrons, so we know that electrons can behave as a particle as well as a wave. It has a dual wave-particle duality. Okay, so before the basic, before observations, unless we observe the electron, we do not know in which state it lies. It is only after the observation, only after making an experiment, making an observation, we can see if we, now, if we make an experiment like photoelectric effect or any other experiment, so it behaves like a particle. Or if we perform an experiment of like electron diffraction, there is an experiment, you know, Davison-Germer experiment. If we perform the diffraction experiment on electron, it exhibits its wave nature. It depends upon us what type of behavior we want to see. The nature having some complex behavior. When we are not observing it, it is in a complex shape, and that is called the superposition of shape. So a quantum state basically is a superposition of the two possible states. The two possible states are zero, cat zero and cat one. Before we observe the system, it is in a complex state, which we call this cat side. It can either be in zero state or can be in one state, but we do not know. It is only after we make an observation, we make an experiment, we observe the state, it will give us the final results. Now, you know that quantum mechanics is a deterministic, is a probabilistic theory. So psi, basically, cat psi is given like alpha, cat zero, beta, cat one, where alpha and beta are complex continuous variable, and alpha square plus beta square is equal to one. Now the probability of zero is given by alpha square, and probability of beta one is given by beta square. So the probability of getting zero is given by alpha square, and probability of getting one is given by beta. This is how a quantum measurement has take place. Now this was the qubit, the basic idea about the qubit. But how physically we realize that, how we can obtain, because ultimately when we have to make a quantum computer, we have to make the qubit physically. So the physical model, the physical realization of the qubit lies in our atomic system. So this is a model of atom, in which two electrons are revolving, although it's nothing to do with the reality, but there are two electrons which are there. I'm saying about the orbits. There are two electrons, there are electrons, one ground state and in excited states. So this is the qubit represented by a two electronic level. So zero, for example, is represented by, represent the ground state, and one, the qubit one, represents the excited states. Now, same thing, unless until we observe, we do not know which state is represented by which electron. It is basically a combination of zero and one. Only then when we measure it, we'll give a final result. Now, the state of a qubit can be described mathematically. Of course, we need a very, 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 very high math, very high level of mathematics for the quantum computation. So the state of a qubit can be described as a vector in two-dimensional Hilbert space. Hilbert space is a complex vector space, you know that. So the qubit is a vector, unit vector in a two-dimensional complex vector space. And these special state, cat zero and cat one, are known as the computational basis states and form an orthonormal basis for that vector space. Of course, you know that quantum states are orthonormal states. Okay, so that I already told you, the probability of one is we got by alpha square, and probability of one we got by beta square. Right now, since alpha square as well beta square is equal to 1, this is essential because only then we can have the finite answer, because total probability is 1. So alpha square beta square is equal to 1. So we can express, we can write mathematically the psi, which was alpha the alpha 0 plus beta 1, like in terms of cos theta and sine theta, like this, where theta and phi defines a point in a three-dimensional sphere. So this is a three-dimensional sphere which we call the Bloch sphere, and this Bloch sphere is used to represent the qubit and also to understand the qubits. Used to understand the qubits. Now, see. So this is our psi. This is our psi. And psi, which is in terms of alpha 0, beta 1. And now we write in terms of cos theta and sine theta and phi. So basically, this psi is written in terms of theta and phi. So what the value psi can have, what the value a psi can have, it depends upon theta and phi. As many combination of theta and phi we can find, as many information we can store in terms of that state. That's very important, basically. That's very important thing. So the question arises now, we are talking about the quantum computers. So how much information is represented by a qubit? It's a very general question. How much information is represented by a qubit? So in principle, if I talk about, there are an infinite number of points on the unit sphere. There are infinite number of points on this sphere in terms of theta and phi. So we can technically, we can in principle have infinite data, which we can store here. Infinite data. Even the data of the total atoms of this universe, even we can store in a single qubit. That's okay. In principle, okay. But the question arises, when we measure, it can store infinite data, as I said, in terms of theta and phi, because we can have infinite number of points which represent theta and phi. So it can store any data, any quantity of data. But remember that measurement of a qubit, when we measure it, what we will get, either 0 or 1. What we will get, either 0 or 1. And furthermore, when we make the measurement, this is a basic postulates of quantum mechanics, basic reality of quantum mechanics. Then when we make a measurement on a system, the state of the system, which was in superposition earlier, now after making a measurement, it will collapse to that measured state. So this is called the collapse of wave function. It's a fundamental principle of quantum mechanics. Means, now, what the information this psi contains, I do not know. It contains infinite data. But ultimately, when I measure, it will give me either 0 or 1 in terms of alpha and beta. So ultimately, when I measure the system, that system, the psi, that state of the system will collapse to the measured state. And that is called the collapse of wave function. Ultimately, means we cannot measure anything without disturbing the system. So that's the basic postulates of quantum mechanics on which this whole thing is based upon. So that was the basic question, that how much information we can store in terms of a qubit. But even more interesting question one might ask, how much information is represented by a qubit if we do not measure it? And the answer is, of course, infinite. It can store infinite data if we do not measure it. It can store infinite data if we not measure it, because the data is stored in terms of alpha and beta, of course, theta and phi, and they can have the infinite number of combinations. So this feature of quantum mechanics allows one to manipulate the information stored in unmeasured qubits with quantum logic gates. Now this unmeasured information can be extracted out using the suitable quantum logic gates. And it is one of the source for the putative power of quantum computers. this is a basic about the qubit. Now, what is a qubit? How much information it can store and what we can measure and how our measurement affects the system. Now, after understanding the qubits, now let's move to the quantum gates. Like in classical mechanics, we are having gates which process the classical data. We are also having the quantum gates. The classical gates, the classical computational gates, you know that are Boolean logic gates that manipulate the information stored in forms of bits. In quantum mechanics, we do have the gates. Mathematically, those gates are represented by the matrices. And can be visualized as a rotation over the Bloch sphere. Now, suppose our original state is psi, which is here, right? Now, when I make a measurement, means I apply a gate. When I apply a gate, what happened to that state? That state moved to my observed state. Okay, it means there is rotation of this state, and that rotation is done by that matrices which I'm talking about. And that matrices are gates. Now, the visualization of these gates on Bloch sphere represent the fact that the quantum gates are unitary operators. I hope you know the unitary operators. Unitary operators means if an operator is multiplied with its complex conjugate, it gives me unit operator. Okay, so all the quantum gates are unitary operators, means they preserve the norm of the quantum states. And one important thing which distinguish the quantum gates from the classical gates, that all the quantum gates are reversible gates. Now, in classical mechanics, only one gate is reversible gates, and that is the NOT gate. But in quantum mechanics, every gate is a reversible gate. Every gate is a reversible gate. So it is a zero loss of energy while performing any operation in quantum. As an example of gates, let me first talk about the single qubit gates. So as I said, in quantum mechanics, the gates are represented theoretically by matrices. And the basic matrices are the Pauli spin matrices, and these act as a single qubit gates. In quantum mechanics, we are having one single qubit gate, multiple qubit gates like that. So this is a matrices which we call the sigma X matrices, sigma X Pauli matrices, and this is sigma Y or Pauli Y matrix. These are standard matrices. Everybody who know the quantum mechanics know about these matrices. And also you have some Z matrices and all these things. Now these matrices act as a basic quantum gates. Let's see how. Now suppose we have a zero state, ket zero. It is a ket zero. When this X gate applies on with this operator, when this matrices operate upon this state, it gives me one state. Now, simple mathematics. See here. The ket zero is ket zero. Basically, I forget to mention that ket zero is a single column matrix, which is 1, 0. And ket one is also a single column matrix, which is represented by 0, 1. So the ket zero is represented by 1, 0. It is single column matrices. So when X, which is my this matrices, operate upon my qubit ket zero, it is simple matrix multiplication. You will find that ultimately I will get 0, 1, and 0, 1 is nothing but ket one. Means this gate converting 0 qubit to converting my state from ket 0 to ket 1. So this is the work of NOT gate. It means the Pauli X matrix is working as NOT gate, quantum NOT gate. And similarly, when it applies upon the ket 1, it definitely changes the state from 1 to 0. So this is a theoretical quantum information science, how this happens. And from here, there, we develop a corresponding practical machines, right? Now, It means when a NOT gate applies upon my superposition state psi, what it does, it converts 1 to 0 and 0 to 1 with corresponding probability given by alpha and beta. Now let's see the Bloch sphere representation of this NOT gate. See here. So this north pole, we call it north pole of this three-dimensional sphere, this is a Bloch sphere. So this state gets zero when a NOT gate, which is of course a unitary operator, applies on this state, it will convert this to one from north pole to south pole, means from zero to one. So this is a simple Bloch sphere, very basic Bloch sphere representation of a quantum NOT gate. One more important gate is the Hadamard gate, which is also a single qubit gate. How much time I left, please?
So you can continue.
Thank you. So this is the one more interesting gate, the Hadamard gate. We call it Hadamard gate. Okay, it is also act on a single qubit. And what it does basically, this gate does not have any classical analog, classical equivalent. Like in NOT gate, we have the classical NOT gate, but there is no classical analog, this Hadamard gate. What this gate does, when it applies to get zero, when I apply this gate on zero qubit, it converts it to a superpositions of zero and one. Convert it to a superposition of 0 and 1 with equal probability. 1 by root 2, 0 plus 1 by root 2, 1. Value of alpha is equal to 1 by root 2. Value of beta is equal to 1 by root 2. And similarly, when it applies on 1, it gives me again the superpositions of 0 and 1, but with negative sign. And this is the corresponding matrix. And this is the corresponding unitary matrix. We can find any matrix corresponding to any gate. That's in our hand now. We can make any mathematical matrix depending upon our need. So the corresponding matrix is this, and this is circuit representation. Right, one of the most important gates in the quantum computing. This is one of the, because it is converting a single state into a superpositions of zero and one state. So what happened, as I said, all quantum gates are reversible gates. So let me prove this. So first, when I apply the Hadamard gate on zero qubit, it will convert into a superposition of zero and one. But when I apply the Hadamard gate again on the output, what happened? I should get zero if it is a reversible gate, of course. So when I apply to the first result, when I apply the Hadamard gate to the first result, it will gives me zero. It means it is a reverse quantum Hadamard gate is a reversible gate. And similarly, when I apply to my second result, it will gives me one. Okay, so these are, we can say that these are pure reversible gates. Now, both states zero and one in the output of the Hadamard gates, we can have zero and one, depending upon what we measure, but with equal probability. The equal probability of one, the equal probability of zero. So let me show using the Bloch sphere representation. So this is my Bloch sphere representation. Here I have zero qubit, here I have one qubit. I don't know, but I can see on the figure, but in actually in reality, I do not know about which state is where. It's just a representation. So when I apply a Hadamard gate, okay, so what I can get? I can either get zero, I can get one, but with equal probability. 50% probability of getting one, 50% probability of get zero. Now, these are the, I discussed the two single qubit gates. Although there are a number of gates, but I only discuss the two important gates, the one qubit gates. Now, I'll discuss one two qubit gate. and we call it controlled NOT gate. The NOT gate, we know what is NOT gate. It is converting CAT 0 to CAT 1, CAT 1 to CAT 0. And it is the work is done by, you know, the unitary matrix X, poly X matrix. Okay. Now, what are the 2-qubit gates? So, 2-qubit gate is a controlled NOT gate. So, means what if we want a controlled operations? Means when I need to convert 0 to 1 only, then it will convert. Otherwise, it will not convert 0 to 1 or vice versa. That's called the controlled NOT gate. So, that we can achieve using this. That we can achieve using this 2-qubit gate. So, this is a 2-qubit gate. So there are 2-qubit input, one this, other is this. So these are input of this 2-qubit gate. This is we call the control bit, and this is we call the target bit. Okay. And here, this is the input qubits, and these are the output qubits. So when I measure the first qubit in output, what I will get the as it is. And when I measure the second qubit in output, what I will get T additional modulo 2C. T additional modulo 2C means I will get the bit target bit flipped when the control bit is 1. What I get in output of second qubit? My output of second qubit is target bit flipped when the control bit is 1. If the control bit is 0, I will get in the output as it is T in the output. Okay. So this is the matrix operation. This is the implementation. So this is, of course, our unitary gates. Here our unitary gate is X matrix because we are discussing the qubit gate. Now let's discuss your periodic table. Sorry, not the truth table. So input, we have qubit 1, qubit 2. So this is control, this is target. And in output, of course, we have control as it is, and qubit 2, this target additional modulo 2C. Right. Now see the output, because this is of our interest, the output of second qubit. You can see the output of first qubit as it is, as we have the input. Now, the output of qubit 2 is depend upon the control. So we will get 0. It was 0 in input, and we get as it is in output 0 because our control bit is 0. And if we have input target bit is 1, we will get as it is in output if our control bit is 0. But if our control bit is 1, what it will do, it will flip the target bit. Means if the target bit is 0 in input, in output we will get 1. And if the target bit is 1 in the input, we will get 0 in the output. It means the flipping is taking place, and this flipping is controlled flipping. Means I am getting the NOT operations. Of course, I am getting the NOT operation, but that NOT operation is taking place with my control. So in our technology, sometimes we need such type of gate. So this is called the control NOT gate, and which is a very basic gate and example of 2-qubit gate. Of course, when I apply this C NOT gate on a superpositions. So here I just applied on a single on a different qubits 0 and 1. But you know that actually we are having a superpositions. So this is a state, particle state represented by phi plus, cat phi plus, which is a superposition. It is 2-qubit, 0, 0, 1, 1. So when I apply the C NOT gate, what happened? So see, so this is a 2-qubit system, cat 0, 0. So the output will be 0, 0, because my first bit, that is the control bit, is 0. Here also 0, 1, I get the 0, 1. But here, I have 1, 0. So my control is 1. So the second bit is 0, flip to 1. So I will get 1, 1. And here, similarly, my control is 1, my target is 1. So my target is flipped from 1 to 0. So in output, I get 1, 0. Right. So therefore, when I apply CNOT gate on this system, what I get will get in the output? I will get 0, 0 here and 1, 0 here in the second gate. Okay, so this is the application of CNOT gate on a superposition of 2-qubit state. Now, after that, after having the basic idea of quantum gates, so once we have the quantum gates, of course, then we use those gates to make a quantum circuit, like we do in classical computation. We make a quantum circuit. Now, quantum circuits are similar to classical computer circuits. Means they consist of wires and logic gates. But in quantum gates, these wires are not basically physical wires. These wires are not physical wires. These wires basically represent the flow of logic. Means time evolution of the state. For example, my state initially is psi, and after making a particular logic operation on that, what will be the state of that that initial state is represented by that wire. So those wires basically are not physical wires, are but the flow of logic. And the input of quantum circuit is assumed to be number of qubits in terms of computational basis states. So these cat 0, cat 1, we call them computational basis. And the output may be computational basis or may be in any arbitrary orthonormal basis. So this is a typical example of quantum circuits. So these are various gates. As I said, this was our Hadamard gate. So this is our X gate. This is our Z gate, Z poly Z gate. And this symbol of a curve and a arrow, these represent the measurement. These represent the quantum measurement. So this is a basically three qubit circuits. Okay, so this flow, these wires basically are representing the flow of logic. It means here when I'm moving from left to right, first of all, here I'll make the I'll operate the H gate on the Q naught, this particular qubit. And similarly here, when I move from here to here, first I make the H operation, the Hadamard operation, then this moves somewhere here, and then the X operation will take place. Okay, so these wires in quantum circuits are not physical wires, as I said. These are just the represent the flow of logic, the time evolution of a quantum state. So this is a typical quantum teleportation circuit. Quantum teleportation is a very, very interesting problem in quantum computation, in which we transport the physical resources from here to somewhere else, no matter what the distance between us is. So that circuit basically is called quantum teleportation circuit. And of course, after having quantum gates, quantum circuits, it will prepare the hardware of a computer ultimately to perform any operation. The brain of computer is the algorithm. Okay, and an algorithm, as I said, various effort has been made in the history, starting from Joza to the Peter Shor. Various algorithm has been proposed. So there are a number of algorithm which we need, of course, to perform any application using quantum computers. Like in classical computers, we need algorithm, like to solution of any problem, or you can simulation of any quantum mechanical system, or to any other problem, we need the quantum algorithm. So there are various algorithm, but I'm specifically interested in Grover search algorithm. It's a very interesting algorithm, which is given by Love Grover in 1995. So this algorithm basically, let me tell you in very, very simple words, this algorithm represent a needle in a haystack. We have a haystack, we have a bundle of haystack, and in that haystack, we have a needle. So if we have to find that needle from that bundle of haystack, how many steps we need? Let me take another problem. We have a phone directory, the classical phone directory we are used to having in our homes earlier, not now. So for example, a phone directory containing 5,000 contacts, roughly, for example. and I have to search a particular number. So how many classical steps, classical computational steps I need for that? Of course, at least 50%. And if I'm unlucky, so I need at least 50,000 steps to find that particular number. But Grover algorithm solved that problem of 5,000 steps to under root of 5,000 steps. Means if I have to search a number out of that 5,000 number phone directory, I only need under root of 5,000 steps. That is only 78 steps. So that is an enormous saving of time as well as of the resources. So I will not go into the detail of this algorithm. This is quite cumbersome mathematically as well as theoretically. But this is the main essence of this algorithm. And of course, finally, as the time up, now let me discuss very briefly the application. Although we are having a lot of application, unlimited number of application in of the computers, of the quantum computers. Like, so specifically, I am discussing the quantum cryptography. So cryptography, let me tell you what is a cryptography is. Cryptography means making something in a secret form, like a secret message. If we have to, I have to communicate with some person, and that message is very, very important message, and I do not want to share that message with anybody else. So what I do, I will encrypt that message into a key. A key is a set of numbers, and I encrypt my message into that key, and then I will send to my friend, and I will let the key know my friend. I will send the key also to him. Okay, so using that key, he or she can encrypt that message and read the message from there. So this is called the quantum cryptography, and this is technique is used from ancient time in our armed forces, in our secret services, elsewhere. You also know that your password, which when we use ATM in our banks, so there is a password and we have to enter, and that password is encrypted. And you know that it is encrypted in 128-bit long key, 128-bit long key. See, that 128-bit long key is a matter of fraction of second to break for a person which is having quantum computers. If someone having quantum computer, he can break that key, he can steal your information within a fraction of seconds. So that is the enormous power of quantum computers. That was a negative part of the quantum computer, but there are positive parts. Okay, so that is called the quantum cryptography. And quantum cryptography, as I said, is called the quantum encryption, which applies to, which uses the principle of quantum mechanics to encode any message. And this is a basic circuits, basically we have to share the key. That key is, message is not important because message are ultimately encrypted. The key is very important. If someone steal my key, my message, of course, stolen. So the key is important. So in quantum computing, quantum information science, this quantum key distribution is very important. So there is a circuit I'm explaining. This is a circuit. There is a two person, Alice and Bob. Alice is sender and Bob is the receiver, who sends the key in terms of single photons. Who sends the keys in terms of single photons. You know that when Alice send a photons, Bob will observe that photons. Okay, so they can talk on a classical channel like telephone, that whether you received the information. So if he do not receive the information, it means someone else, eavesdropper, someone else has taken that data. It means if someone try to steal my information, ultimately the receiver will automatically know. Therefore, the stealing is not possible. This stealing is not possible. It is based upon very basic quantum mechanical process. You know, when someone observe a quantum state, it will destroy it, as I said. When I have to make a measurement on a quantum state, it will ultimately destroy that state. Okay, so based upon this quantum mechanical fundamental principle, the this quantum key distribution has been discussed. So, of course, that's all from my side. And the person who is interested in this wonderful subject can read this quantum computation and quantum information by Michael A. Nielsen and Isaac L. Chuang, which is of the Cambridge University Press book. So thank you. This is all from my side. Thank you very much. If you have having any questions, let's discuss.
Thank you, Dr. Mukhtiar, for the wonderful talk and sharing your expert views on quantum information science. The session is open for the question, if anyone want to ask. All right. Participants have posted some questions in chat box. So, sir, I am going to ask one by one. The first question is, it is in the chat box of YouTube. The student is asking that quantum computers, they work in 200 seconds in comparison to the supercomputer.
10,000 years. 10,000 years of classical computer.
So it solved the task because of speed or because of its precision?
Both. Because unless speed is one thing, and unless until we are having the precision, we cannot expect the exact solution of that problem. So precision is important as well as the speed.
Okay.
If we have to solve a problem, ultimately precision is important.
Thank you, sir. And the next question is, what are the challenges researchers face in developing a quantum computer?
So the challenges are basically because it is very difficult right now to make a quantum computers, because to make the quantum mechanical system and then make a measurement on those system is currently is very difficult. You know that is a very cumbersome process. And as far as the implementation of quantum computers is concerned, the quantum mechanical channels, making quantum mechanical channels is one challenges, and other is the distance. So right now the quantum key distribution, there is a Indian company called QNU company. He has demonstrated a 500 kilometer quantum key distribution. For example, one person is here and other is sitting at the 500 kilometer. So they successfully send the secured key from in that interval of 500 kilometers. But still we are lacking far behind. Okay, so the distance is other concerns. So like these are the basically some concerns which the experimentalists are facing right now.
Okay, sir. There is one more question. For how long we can store data in quantum computer?
Unless until we measure it. Unless yes. Until we measure it. Jaise hi aapne usko measure kiya, data khatam. That based upon the quantum, basic idea of quantum computing. Quantum. Because we got the result. So what we do with that, that junk, that will destroy it.
And the next question is there a theory beyond quantum theory or a science beyond quantum science?
Or see, let me take 2-3 minutes to answer these questions. There are various scientists during 3-4 centuries of literature, the history of science, who said various things about this. Like at the end of 19th century, Lord Kelvin, you know that Lord Kelvin, he said that because at that time the classical physics was at its peak. So he said that all the physics has been discovered, and the thing remains is the precise measurement. Means there is no need to discover new laws. He said at the end of 19th century. And at the starting of 20th century, a new branch like quantum mechanics evolved. Okay. Now at the end of 20th century, Stephen Hawking, you know that in his 1982 papers, he said that quantum theory is the theory of everything. And there is no need to discover, to make new theories, to develop new theories. Okay, of course, quantum mechanics would be the theory of everything. But right now we are in direction to make this theory of everything. Right now, you know that there are four fundamental forces of nature. Okay. Except the gravitational forces, all three forces have been implemented in quantum mechanics. But we are still lacking to implement the gravitational forces in quantum mechanics. Of course, quantum mechanics will be the theory of everything. It will be the versatile theory, but still we are have some time for that. Maybe in next 20 to 30 years, it will be the theory of everything. As far as my knowledge is concerned, we do not need any theory beyond quantum mechanics because it is the theory of everything.
Okay, thank you, sir. And Gurmeet Jagra has asked again, that is there a relationship between string theory and quantum theory?
String theory basically is a theory, as I said, which is unification, which basically the unification of all four forces. That is the theory concerned with the unification of all four forces. Okay, and the quantum theory is beyond that.
Thank you very much, sir, for answering all the questions. There is announcement for the participants that you have to fill the feedback form. The link of the feedback form is given in the chat box, similarly in the YouTube chat box. You must fill that feedback form to get the e-certificates. Now, I would like to invite our Honorable Principal, sir, to continue the session. Please, sir.
गुड इवनिंग मुख्तार जी.
नमस्कार.
सर ठीक हो?
हाँ सर बढ़िया, आप बताइए.
बस सर बहुत अच्छा लगा, बहुत ब्यूटीफुली यू एक्सप्लेन्ड एवरीथिंग.
थैंक यू सर.
ब्यूटीफुली एक्सप्लेन्ड आंसर्स द क्वेश्चंस. और मैं बड़ा गर्व महसूस होता है कि मुख्तार जी ने हमारे कॉलेज में काम किया है और आज आप बहुत अच्छी जगह पर जो है बैठे हैं. बहुत 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 धन्यवाद आपका कि आपने हमारा इनविटेशन एक्सेप्ट किया और इतना ब्यूटीफुल प्रेजेंटेशन, इतना वंडरफुल प्रेजेंटेशन जो है हमारे लिए दिया आपने. हम आपका बहुत बहुत आभारी हैं. और मैं भी पार्टिसिपेंट्स का जिन्होंने इस वेबिनार में हिस्सा लिया है सबका बहुत बहुत आभार व्यक्त करता हूँ, स्वागत करता हूँ. और मैं हार्टिएस्ट कॉन्ग्रेचुलेशन टू द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फिजिक्स, चेतन जी, नरेंद्र जी एंड अदर टीम मेंबर्स for organizing such a wonderful, wonderful जो है webinar.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, Mukhtar ji. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Should I leave, sir? Chetan sir, should I leave?
Now I would like to invite Narendra sir to for a formal welcome, sir.
Sir, namaskar. Thank you, Chetan sir, for giving me this opportunity to thank a fine researcher and a fine human being, Dr. Mukhtar Singh.
Yeah,
exactly. We are thankful to Dr. Mukhtar Singh, Assistant Professor, Department of Applied Physics, Delhi Technological University, for enlightening us with his lecture on quantum information science, explaining futuristic developments in computation with help of quantum mechanics. He explained that we can store infinite data by using quantum computation, and certainly quantum computation is future computation. Dr. Mukhtar Singh beautifully explained milestones of electronics, explained qubit, quantum gates, quantum circuits, quantum algorithm. And his lecture was totally research-oriented lecture, and he beautifully introduced a new topic for research to students. Our sincere thanks to Dr. Vikramjit Singh, Principal Dayanand College Hisar, for providing necessary resources for organizing this webinar. Also, we are thankful to Mr. Chetan Sharma, HOD Physics Department, for organizing this webinar. We are thankful to all members of the organizing committee who worked hard for the success of this webinar. We are thankful to all students and researchers who attended this webinar. Students and researchers will definitely get benefited with fascinating idea of quantum computation. We wish to organize such knowledgeable, knowledge enhancing and beautiful lecture in real meeting as soon as it will be possible. Thank you, Mukhtar sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much, Chetan sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir. Okay. Bye.
Bye.